Is that okay now?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, so on this session, we are talking about how to achieve the low latency NFV with the OpenStack. And I'm Yunhong Jiang. I'm from Intel Open Source Technology Center. I've been working on the hypervisor, KVM, Zen, and also on the Nova. So currently, I'm working on the KVM for NFV project. So this is a project on the OpenNFV side, and we will talk about it later. So I can give some very small background introduction to why we come to this topic. So as I will talk of later, the KVM for NFV project is to provide a hypervisor, or maybe a real-time hypervisor to the NFV usage scenario. And one major purpose is to achieve the very low latency NFV. And we have a whole bunch of the test cases running on our lab. So because we began our work last year, at that time, the whole Nova and the Neutron is not ready for the low latency NFV at all. So we have to use the batch scripts to achieve our purpose. We have about 20 batch files to do our testing. So it's not easy to maintain and to change. Especially when we begin to do more and more workload testing, like run, launch, maybe 10 and 20 virtual machines at the same time, and still testing the latency result, something is quite difficult. That's the reason we turn to the OpenStack to hope to make sure our test case using the OpenStack to be more automatically, and also it will be in the same way as the OpenNFV test CI/CD process. So the investigation and our trial come to this topic. So the agenda. Firstly, I will talk about the NFV and the network latency. And then I will deep dive into the detail why the network latency will be an issue on the NFV side. And then I will talk about how to achieve the low latency NFV. And in the end, I will give some example of the how to set up the whole stack, including the hypervisor, the virtual switch, the open stack, the whole thing to achieve the low latency NFV. So first, the NFV and the network latency. So as everyone knows, the network latency is very important. So for different network service, maybe the importance will be different, and also the impact will be different. And also the requirement of different network function will also be different. For example, for the VoIP service, if the network latency is too known, maybe the voice quality will be bad. And normally, it says that the latency should be less than 150 milliseconds. And for the interactive game, like the online game, if the latency is too known, maybe the gamer have to wait a long time for the response from the game server, and impact the user appearance. And normally, maybe it should be less than 100 milliseconds. And for some like base station, depends on which layer of the protocol we are talking, sometimes the latency should be less than 1 millisecond. And some extreme scenario, like the algorithmic trading, which is like using the automatic program to do the stock exchange. On this scenario, maybe the latency requirement will be something like tens or hundreds of microseconds. And the latency, if there are some very low latency, even the whole stock exchange will fail, and the profit will be impacted. That's really the money. Yeah. So you can see the latency is really, really important. And also I want to emphasize that when we talk about latency, it's about end-to-end latency. For example, take the VoIP service as an example. When one people calling from computer A to the computer B, to people on computer B, they maybe have several network function nodes will be involved. Maybe including two computer node endpoint, some edge router, and some call router. So the end-to-end latency means all the latency happens in these five machines in total should be less than 150 milliseconds. So for each node, maybe the budget will be only less than 30 milliseconds. So it's important, right? And also the number will be much lower than the 150. Another one is latency is related to throughput, but normally it's not so strictly related. In most of the time, it should be two dimensions of the network performance. And so come to the NFV and the network latency. So I think the NFV is very hot on this OpenStack Summit, and everyone is talking about the NFV. So per my understanding, basically the NFV is a change to the traditional network function deployment. Traditionally, the network function will be deployed in the hardware platform, like the hardware of hardware firewall, hardware router or switch. And on the NFV scenario, the network function is not running on the hardware, instead it's running on a virtual machine. And the virtual machine will be hosted by the high volume servers. And because of the virtualization, it brings a whole bunch of the benefit, for example, the flexibility and the manageability. With the virtual machine, it will be very easy to create more and more virtual machine if the requirement for the network transaction is increased. And then we can destroy or just post the virtual machine if there's no such big requirement anymore. And also because there's no need to host so many hardware platform, like the hardware firewall, hardware router, the cost of the network administrator, the cost of the air conditioning and the power will all be reduced. And the most important is, with the virtual machine, it will be easy to create a new virtual machine, so there's no need for the design, testing, and the verification of the hardware platform, which will be a very long time, maybe every several years. But with the virtual machine, it will be much easier to deploy, to testing and deploy. So it will decrease the time to market a lot. But although the NFV have so many benefits, it still have a whole bunch of issues, and one of the major issues will be the latency. Especially if we talk about some scenario, like the latency requirement will be 100 microseconds, the latency is really something we have to consider seriously on the NFV side. So in this session, I will talk about the deep analysis, where the network latency comes from. So this is a very simple example of the OpenStack environment. So on this environment, you can see there will be a VNFV CPU, which means the virtual network function. And it is in fact hosted on a virtual machine. And on this virtual network function, there will be some network function to run like the router or firewall. It will receive the packet from the virtual NIC. And then after some handling, it will send the packet to the virtual NIC also. But so the time from the virtual NIC to the network function and the back is mostly similar as what happened on the physical network function. But there will be some extra time that happens from the packet received by the hardware NIC on the real platform till the packet is received by the virtual NIC. So we can see this is a very generic OpenStack deployment, right? There will be one component is the OVS kernel module, which will do the virtual switch, most of the virtualization of the network. There will be the KVM vhost, which is the hypervisor to the virtual machine. And also you can notice the virtual VNFV CPU is in fact is running on the same CPU core together with some other vCPU, which probably is some non-VNF vCPU, or some apps, or some service. So in this situation, the network comes from the whole bunch of the flow from the packet received by the NIC to the packet received by the virtual NIC. And I will give them more analysis from the packet process, packet flow point of view. Firstly, for example, when the NIC, the packet received by the NIC, right, the NIC have to tell the OVS kernel module there's a packet arrived, it will go through the interrupt. But at that time, maybe the OVS kernel module is not running, or maybe even the CPU call is running for service, or not a higher priority interrupt. So there will be some latency happen for the packet for the hardware NIC to notify the OVS kernel module of the through the interrupt. And even the interrupt is received by the kernel module, because normally in the Linux kernel space, the packet is handled by the software IRQ context. But the software IRQ may get another delay because software IRQ can be preempted by other higher priority interrupter or by other software IRQ. So second latency. And the third one is because for the OVS kernel module, it will use the generic kernel network stack. Maybe you know the kernel stack is not optimized for the NFV packet processing scenario, it's the handling of the buffer, the packet queue is not so efficient from the packet processing point of view. So there will be a the third latency will be the kernel stack. And the fourth one will be on the current OpenStack environment, there will be multiple bridges be created to handle the packet forwarding, mostly for the security purpose. For example, in a generic neutron environment, there will be the integration bridge and also the physical bridge. So the packet have to be copied between these different bridges, and it will bring another layer of the latency. So in the end, after all of the latency, the packet is received and handled by the OVS kernel module, and then sent to the KVM and the vhost. But here it will come another whole bunch of the latency. The first one is for the packet to be received by the vhost, the OVS kernel module have to notify the vhost, and at that time it may go through the virtual interrupt. But it is in current virtualization, both the KVM and the Zen, the interrupt controller is eliminated, so it will bring another branch of the latency. Normally, the elimination of the interrupt controller may bring 20 microseconds delay in some situation. So in the end, after finish the virtualization overhead, the packet is received by the vhost, right? And we try to put the packet to the guest. But at the time, another latency may happen because as we know, on the kernel space, there will be a lot of the threads of the interrupt or ISR, right? So it most possibly, maybe the VCP is not running at that time. It's being preempted by some kernel thread, like the RCU kernel thread, or by some ISR, like the timer ISR, or maybe some other ISR or thread. So this is another latency. And luckily, for example, we have the VCP not be preempted by any kernel thread, not by preempted by any ISR. Another chance is because, as we said, the WinF VCPU is sharing the same CPU core together with other non-WinF VCPU or another generic application. Maybe in some situation, maybe the OpenStack Nova computer node service is running on the same CPU core. So at that time, the VCPU is scheduled out already, and the other application is running. So they'll cause some VCPU scheduling cost. And another one, in the end, the VCPU is running, it's not preempted, it's not scheduled out. The VCPU receives the packet, right? It will begin to handle the packet, just like in the physical network function scenario. They will still have another issue is the virtualization overhead. For example, when the VCP is running the network function, it may cause some transaction to the KVM hypervisor to finish the virtualization for some device model, for example. So that transition may cause at least the most fast KVM transition will take 10 microseconds in latest hardware. So that is still another latency cost. And in the end, there's another one is hardware resource contention. For example, maybe there's some, as you know, in current CPU architecture, there's some CPU cache will be shared by multiple CPU core. So although the vCPU is running on this CPU core, but it have to contend with other applications running on other CPU core for the L3 cache, for the memory bandwidth, for the TLB, everything. So the WinF vCPU have to contend the hardware resource with other application. So you can see we analysis the packet flow from the hardware leak to tier the packet received by the virtual hardware leak, like the virtual I/O leak. And you can see in this process, there are so many latency may happen, and each latency will impact the final result, right? So this on this page, we try to analyze from the packet process point of view. And on the next page, I will try to categorize the latency type. So basically, I think there are two types of the latency. The one type is the resource contention. The resource may include the hardware CPU, the physical cache, like the L3 cache, or TAB, or memory, or even I/O, for example, if the leak is shared by multiple CPU. And the contention will come from the other vCPU, other application, other service, or even kernel service, like the RCU callback thread, the ISR on the kernel, So a whole bunch of people were trying to contain the hardware resource with the VNF CPU and the impact latency. Another type of the virtualization overhead is the, another type of the latency comes from the virtualization overhead. So basically, because the virtualization is implemented by different software, the CPU, memory, and I/O is supported by the KVM hypervisor, and the network may come from the virtual switch in some situation, the Linux bridge, right? Or maybe other open source or other closed source virtual switch. So the virtualization may come from the CPU and the I/O virtualization. For example, as I said, interrupt controller is kind of eliminated. So all the interrupt controller access will cause the overhead. And the network is sure every packet will copy between multiple bridges. It will cause some latency. So this is the root cause of the latency, the resource contention and the virtualization overhead. So how can we achieve the low latency NFV? Still going back to the reason of the latency, right? So for the resource contention, we can do several things. For example, we can reduce the contention cost. That means, for example, if the when the packet arrived for the VNF CPU, but there is another application is running, if we can reduce the time the switch from the another application to the virtual CPU, it is sure to be sure to reduce the latency. Another one will be like the priority, we can raise the vCPU thread priority. So even there is other applications waiting for running, the VNF CPU will get a higher priority and can service the packet faster. And on some extreme situation, maybe we want to exclusively reassign some resource to the virtual CPU. And I think in previous session, we have several talk about the CPU pinning, the SIRV, all of this is to the purpose to assign the resource to the virtual CPU exclusively. And for the virtualization overhead, there's for the CPU and the I/O side, for example, you can use the advanced virtualization feature that provided in the latest hardware. For the Intel platform, have more and more hardware feature to enhance the virtualization. And also, we should enhance the KVM hypervisor or other like hypervisor to reduce the virtualization overhead. And for the network side, there's several options. For example, we can use the SIRV to reduce the virtualization overhead. There will still be some. Although it seems the SRV can avoid all the virtualization overhead, but if you analyze the whole process, even with the SRIOV assignment, there may still be 10 or 20 microseconds delay because of the interrupted virtualization. Another choice is to use some software mechanism like the OVS DPDK to enhance the network virtualization. We will talk about it in future. So, to achieve, as you can see, the whole latency comes from the virtual switch, comes from the hypervisor, comes from the contention of the hardware resource, right? So to really achieve the low latency NFV, we have to provide a systematic solution for the whole stack, from the hardware to the virtual switch, to the hypervisor, to the application. Everything has to be done, and of course, OpenStack. And I will talk this one by one. So this is in the right side is a picture of what will be done in the end to achieve the extreme low latency environment. And this is in fact what we are doing for our KVM for NFV project testing. So you can see on this scenario, every virtual network function, virtual CPU will exclusively own one CPU core. All the other application and other virtual CPU thread will be moved to other CPU core. And even the other kernel thread and other kernel ISR will be moved to other CPU core. Of course, in generic CPU or Linux, it's not so easy to achieve that. We have to use some special RT Linux to support and remove all the thread to the other CPU core. And also, the KVM kernel module is not used anymore. Instead, a user space OVS, DPDK OVS will be used to polling the thread to achieve the latency, handle latency. And the hardware side will have also a whole bunch of enhancement. Yeah, so as we said, we have to do the full stack systematic solution to achieve the low latency, especially the very extremely low latency NFV. So with this scenario, for example, we can just assign a NIC card to the virtual net function. So we can reduce the cost a lot because that, as we said, the vCPU does not have no contention with any other kernel thread or any other application. And the NIC device is assigned also, right? So the latency will be very low, maybe just 20 or 30 microseconds. Another solution, as we said, use the OVS DBTK. So the packet will go through from the hardware NIC card to the OVS DBTK PMD thread and go to the vCPU directly. So we overwhelmed the interrupt latency, the soft echo latency, the kernel stack, and also the packet forwarding in the between multiple bridge. So firstly, we have a look of the advanced hardware platform. VTD and SRV actually is not so advanced anymore. It has been there for a long time. So with the VTD and SRV, we can reserve the I/O device for the virtual machine to avoid the contention for the I/O side. And the PI is some new feature, I think it's on hardware platform. Basically, the purpose is to inject or interrupt directly to the guest. So we reduce the interrupt virtualization overhead. And this way is especially important for the SRIOV. It will, in the end, remove all the virtualization overhead for the SRIOV. And the CAT is a new hardware feature that is in the broadware just released recently. So with the CAT, the idea of the CAT is to reserve part of the cache for the VNF vCPU. So no, even there are some other application running on another CPU core try to contain the CPU cache with the VNF vCPU. Because of the CAT, the part of the cache will be reserved for the VNF vCPU, and the other application cannot be used, cannot use it anymore. So they achieve the cache level reservation. And on top of the hardware platform, the real-time hypervisor is also important. And generically, we're talking about the Linux side, Linux and KVM. Of course, I know there are some effort on the Zen side for the real-time hypervisor. I have no idea about the KVM, the VMware or Hyper-V. So to achieve the low latency NFV, there's a whole bunch of enhancements have to be done on the real-time hypervisor. For example, the real-time scheduler. With the real-time scheduler, we can achieve the higher priority for the vCPU thread. And also the full permission support. That means, for example, even there the application is running, the packet achieved, right? The vCPU thread will immediately preempt that running application and begin handling the packet. So it will reduce the contention cost. And also with the real-time hypervisor, all the kernel activity, like the ISR, soft IRQ, everything will be done by the thread context. And this thread can be moved to other CPU core and will not contain with the VNF vCPU. Basically, we will achieve the real CPU reservation for the vCPU thread. And of course, CPU isolation to isolate the CPU for the guest. So the Linux scheduler will not try to schedule any other application or any other vCPU to the same CPU core. There's a whole bunch of the feature, in fact, will achieve different level of the latency. And also, I'll give some simple introduction of the KVM for NFV project that we are working on. This is a project based on the upstream real-time Linux kernel. And we have tuned the kernel configuration very carefully to achieve the low latency. And also, there are some patch that is dependent, will be on this tree and will be pushed to upstream also to even reduce the latency. For example, there are several enhancements for the KVM hypervisor to the VFIO to reduce the latency. This KVM for NFV has been included in the B release of the OPNFV. And in the C release, we hope it's the whole testing with the OpenStack support, right? The whole testing will be integrated to the OPNFV test framework and the CI/CD. And the project, in fact, have a whole bunch of the active contributor from the OPNFV community. Intel is one major player, and Nokia contributed a lot also, and Wind River also contributed to it. And so we'll finish the talk of the hardware platform and hypervisor, which is the most important part for the CPU and the I/O side. And for the network side, we said we will do the SIOV to achieve the very low latency NFV, but it has been discussed in last sessions. SIOV have some issue, like the migration or the security group. And another choice is to use the software accelerator, like the DBDK OVS, for the low latency NFV. For those people who have no idea of what's the DBDK, so I can give a very short introduction. Basically, DBDK is a library that first is introduced by Intel, and now is supported by the open source community. The idea is to improve the packet processing on the Intel hard architecture. And now, of course, it also supports ARM and other architecture. Initially, it's only for Intel. And the DBDK will bypass all the Linux network stack. And we just said, the kernel network stack will bring some latency to the OVS kernel module, right? And also with the DBDK, the user space can access the hardware register directly. The DBDK will have one pony mode thread running in the user space to it continuous poning for the if there are any packet arrived. So with this pony mode, we avoid the interrupt latency. And also it has its own implementation for the queue and the buffer management. That is basically to achieve to avoid the network stack on the kernel and to enhance the latency. So with the DBDK is a generic library, and it currently has been used to enhance the open virtual switch. So here's an example of how the OVS or DBDK OVS is working. So you can see there's a user space or PMG thread, which will continue poning the interrupts if there are any packet arrived on the hardware network card. And if there are any, it will pass the packet directly from the user space to the guest. So there will be no context switch from the kernel KVM vhost to the virtual I/O NIC anymore. So with the PMG thread, with the code buffer management, and with the user space vhost, it really achieve very low latency NFV. And this the hardware platform, the hypervisor, and the DBDK OVS is a low-level functionality to support the low latency NFV. And another layer will be the OpenStack layer for the orchestration. So for the Nova or for the computer side, there will be made two efforts. The first one is the Nova have to contract the computer node very carefully. For example, the Nova should know what's the physical CPU that has been reserved for the virtual machine exclusively. And then we need to try to assign the isolated CPU or reserved CPU to the virtual machine. They will make sure the CPU will not be assigned to multiple virtual machine or multiple virtual CPU, right? And also when the Nova try to create the virtual machine, it will make sure the VNF virtual machine will get the reserved resource allocation, and also the VCP thread will get a very high priority scheduled. So it will be scheduled in very high priority than other normal thread. And of course there are it makes sure the NUMA support, the host page support. And also for neutral side, it have to support the virtual NIC port corresponding to the SIRIOV NIC. And also it have to support the DBDK OVS and the vhost user scenario. So on this session, I've talked about how we should do the full stack implementation to achieve the very low latency NFV, including the hardware platform, the real-time hypervisor, the DBDK enhanced OVS, and also it requires support from the OpenStack, both Nova and Neutron, to achieve the orchestration. And so we can have a look at the setup and the configurations. In fact, the configuration of the whole stack is not so easy. As I said, we have about 20 scripts to do the overhaul testing. And for example, for the RTNX testing setup, we have to support a static parameter to reserve the CPU for the VNF and to move a whole bunch of the kernel thread, like the RCU callback thread or the timer thread, to other non-reserved CPU. And on the runtime, when the kernel is up, we have to change the interrupt affinity, change the watchdog, change the RCU callback thread affinity. It's a whole bunch of things. For the GPTK OS, it's another whole bunch of story. We have, for example, we have to kind of back most of the distribution have no GPTK OS at all. So we have to upgrade to the GPTK OS instead of the normal OS, so we can use the user mode GPTK. And also we have to arrange the whole PMD thread affinity very carefully. So for example, we don't want to have two pony model thread on the same CPU call and the content with each other. So it's sure to bring a whole bunch of the network latency. But unluckily, all this host configuration cannot be done by the OpenStack yet. We are still trying to figure out if the Ironic can help us to automatically set up the host configuration by the Ironic project. But it's still on the road. And so the second one will be configured as OpenStack. So we have to configure the computer node. For example, as we said, the kernel parameter will specify what's the CPU that is reserved by the kernel, right, for the VNF only. But we have to pass the information from the kernel to the OpenStack, to the Nova, so that Nova will know the CPU, for example, the CPU 3 to CPU 10 is reserved for the VNF CPU only. And when the Nova tries to launch the VNF CPU, it will know which CPU will be used. And also, it will track, for example, if we have 10 CPU reserved for the VNF scenario, right? The Nova have to know, for example, 3 physical CPU has been assigned to the virtual CPU already, so only 7 left. And what's the left CPU for the in future VNF CPU? The whole thing have to be tracked very carefully by the Nova computer node. And the Nova have to specify, like, we should avoid any CPU oversubscription. So we don't want two VNF CPU running on the same CPU, right? So normally you have to set the CPU allocation ratio to be 1, so there will be no two virtual CPU on the same CPU core. And also we don't want oversubscription of the RAM. And for the PCI, we have to tell the OpenStack what's the PCI device that has been reserved by the kernel, especially for the VNF CPU. So the data have to track the PCI device assignment carefully. So this is the whole thing that has been done by the computer node. And also for the VM flavor, when the Nova try to create a VNF or VCPU, it have to, as we said, it have to specify a whole bunch of the property for the VM. Have to specify, for example, what's the VCPU this virtual machine will run, and what's the VCPU thread priority? Should it be a high priority, like the real-time priority, or the normal one? And should it be like the, because as we say, the cumul will be supported for the VCP thread, right? It also have to arrange the cumul thread carefully for the VCPU. So there are a whole bunch of the VM flavor have to be specified for the VM creation. And we have to configure the neutron side also for the GPTK OVS and the SRIV. In fact, per our investigation, I think the GPTK OVS support is still on the way. It should technically be ready, but there are some several enhancements still pending. For example, currently the GPTK OVS security group is not merged yet. So although we can create the virtual machine with the GPTK OVS, but there will be no security group supported for the virtual machine. And also, as I said, even currently with the GPTK OVS, there will be multiple bridges, including the integration bridge, the physical bridge, tunnel bridge, still be created by the neutron or agent. So the packet will still have to be forwarded between these multiple bridges. So I'm not sure if anyone is working to, like, only one bridge on the neutron agent, so to achieve the very, very extremely low network latency scenario. So that will still something we have to look. And for the SRIV, I think Neutron is quite ready and has been working for a long time. Yeah. So the whole config, this is summary of what I talk. We analyze the reason of the network latency in the NFV scenario. And also we analyze the whole workflow from the packet received by the NIC card till the packet is transformed to the virtual NIC card. The latency from the OVS kernel module to the hypervisor to the kernel thread operating machine to the other VCP machine. So, and we also give our proposal of the full stack systematic solution to reduce the network latency. But here comes to something call to action. The first one is the documentation. We really hope the OpenStack project have a more clear documentation for the how to set up the whole thing. In fact, when we do the investigation, I have to work to check the Nova source code to know what should we do, what's the reason or what's the meaning of the different Nova configuration or the VM flavor configuration meaning. Luckily, I know about the Nova source code, but not everyone knows about that. So documentation is really important, and I think it's something we have to done, have to do. And also is that we said, currently to do the host configuration is not so easy. The kernel parameter, the kernel configuration, runtime configuration, the OVS, DBDK, OVS, PMG thread affinity, the whole bunch of things, I think kind of have to be done manually before we use the OpenStack to launch. So this is also something we have to do more investigation, especially we need to check if Ironic will support it. And another one is the automatic latency test. Currently, in either the OpenStack or the OpenFV have no testing plan or no test case to the latency of testing. And that may bring some issue that we don't know. So that's something I think we should do in future. And this is some reference to the configuration. The first one is some week for the KVM for NFV project. It gave a very detailed step by step from how to configure the BIOS, how to configure the kernel parameter, to configure the kernel runtime environment. And the second one is some source code. In fact, this is the major source I have to check on how to set up the OVS DBDK environment. Yeah, it's on the GitHub. And I hope there will, in future there will be more and more documentation of the OS DBDK. And the third one is about the SRILV. Oh, the last one is about the SRILV. The third one is about how to tune the OVS DBDK to achieve low latency. It's from the OVS official documentation. OK, that's all.
Good presentation.
Thank you.
I would like to know, since you mentioned Ionic, are you, Ionic only does the bare metal.
So what?
Bare metal. Bare metal provisioning.
Okay.
So are you looking at only bare metal provisioning in KVM for NFV, or are you also looking at the virtualized implementation?
Well, I think for bare metal, of course, we can achieve very low latency, right? Comparing to the virtualization, virtual machine environment.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that the reason is because if we are using the bare metal, we may miss a whole bunch of the flexibility and the manageability. So the reason we can't focus on the KVM virtualization scenario, and also because we begin our work for the testing of the KVM for NFV project. So we begin, our focus is more on the virtualization side and the KVM side.
So another relevant question to you. Obviously, we are looking at low latency from different angle.
Yeah.
One of them is live migration, maybe. Another could be cloudlet, which is at the cloud, a VM at the edge of the cloud.
VM?
VM at the cloud, edge cloud.
Okay.
So what I am thinking, this is, we are planning to have a project called Cloudlet under OpenStack for the tier two cloud. That is, you have the main cloud, you have the edge cloud, and I'm looking at, can we tie these two together? Cloudlet for NFV, let's say, I call it. Example, just a project name, let's say. Because you are dealing only with the CPU level optimization. I'm looking at network latency optimization, or at least coordination between the two. You may not be able to do light, speed of light is the limit we know. That's what we can achieve. But even then, can we do some coordination in that?
Maybe yes. Peter, we can talk later about your project.
I think I'll come to you on that and to take your support.
And you can see we also talk about the neutron enhancement with the OVS GPGK. There's also some part of the network enhancement too for the low latency. But yes, we can have more talk.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Did you have any measurements of before and after for latency?
In fact, what we compare is that because as we said, we have a whole bunch of scripts, right, to do the very careful arrangement. And also we try to use the OpenStack to do the arrangement. So with the SRIOV scenario, basically we get a similar environment with our script. That means the manual setup and the OpenStack setup. For the OVS GPGK, frankly speaking, we didn't finish all the setup yet, because yet we can see the multiple bridge for the packet from bridge one, integration bridge, to the physics bridge, to the tunnel bridge. So basically, the kind of OVS GPGK cannot meet our test requirement, so we didn't try in future. But for the SRIOV scenario, yes. Basically, the OpenStack environment achieved a similar result as our script environment. And for the packet forwarding, we do some very simple one to run air to forward application on the virtual machine, and the latency should be less than 15 microseconds.
15 microseconds?
Yeah.
As opposed to what would it have been without the...
If we don't do any optimization, like the kernel thread, have no optimization of the affinity reservation, the number is meaningless, more than 1 millisecond.
Maybe you already alluded to this, or maybe I just didn't understand, as I'm not too familiar with you know, the real-time Linux know, project. But is the goal for these enhancements to be rolled into the existing KVM binary, or would this be a parallel KVM binary specific for an over-the-call for NFV type functions?
Our purpose is to enhance the KVM for the generic scenario. Maybe, for example, there may be some special configuration, kernel parameter is needed. But the purpose is it will be in the generic one.
Okay.
So our patch will be pushed to upstream.
Okay, great.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.